Good morning. I'm Judge Marcia Peckman, and I have the honor today to be introducing you to two people. The first is Professor Elyn Saks, and I'm going to tell you that you should look at her great accomplishments that you'll find in your materials, but I think that the thing that I would like to convey to you is I happen to believe that Elyn Saks is one of the most courageous people that I have ever met, as well as perhaps one of the most brilliant. She's courageous because she's going to tell you a story that many of us don't like to hear. She's going to tell you a story that will make you realize that mental illness touches all of us. It touches us personally. It touches us through our friends, our family, our siblings, our children, our parents. Fully 1 in 4 people in America have mental illness. And so if you take a look at this room, I'm saying, okay, everybody from here over. And if you don't think you, if you can say to yourself, I don't know somebody who is mentally ill, I'm going to say you're not paying attention. Because we certainly know in our work that mental illness touches everything that we do. It touches those litigants who come in, it touches the people that we sentence, it touches those people who are on supervision through our probation departments, it touches us every time we open the newspaper and hear another story. So that's why the committee felt it was so important to talk about this today. It's uncomfortable to talk about mental illness. Professor Saks and I happen to share a common bond. We are breast cancer survivors. And when I was chatting with her last night, one of the things I said that was my first thought when I got my diagnosis was, oh, thank God I have a nice disease. And she said, yes. When you get something like cancer, you get flowers, you get casseroles, and you get everyone rallying around. There are no flowers or casseroles in mental health institutions. The second person I'm going to introduce today is our own Jeremy Fogel, who we all know from the wonderful programs that he puts on with his staff at the FJC. And the one thing I'm going to say that you may not know about Judge Fogel is that he started his career as a mental health advocate. And so he is going to have the privilege of doing question and answer with Professor Saks. We also are going to have questions from the audience. And so you'll see on your tables those yellow cards. Members of the committee, if you are going to be circulating amongst the group, if you just hold up your yellow card and write your question on it, we will take those questions at the end of the program. So, may I please introduce Professor Elyn Saks.
Hi. Thank you. Thank you, Judge Peckman, for that lovely introduction. I'm deeply honored to be asked to speak here. I confess I've spoken to lawyers, consumers and family members, mental health professionals, but never before judges. I'm delighted to be here today. I hope you don't judge me too harshly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to narrate the story of my struggles with schizophrenia, hoping to put a human face on the illness. I punctuate the narrative by reading passages from my memoir, The Center Cannot Hold, My Journey Through Madness. I will then turn to the more legal part of my talk, where I focus on one interesting mental health law issue, the right of civil committees to refuse medication and competency to refuse. And I conclude with some other policy implications of my story, recognizing that I'm an N of only one. So who am I? I'm Orrin B. Evans, Professor of Law, Psychology, and Psychiatry in the Behavioral Sciences at the USC Gould School of Law. I'm an adjunct professor of psychiatry at UCSD Medical School, and I'm on the faculty of the New Center for Psychoanalysis. I'm also a patient with chronic schizophrenia. I was given, quote, very poor and, quote, grave prognoses. In other words, expected to be unable to live independently, let alone to work. So how did I manage to fashion a good life for myself in the face of this mental illness? My memoir tells that story, and I hope to tell it today. My central goals in writing my story are twofold: to give hope to those who suffer from schizophrenia and understanding to those who don't. So I grew up in sunny Florida with caring and attentive parents and two younger brothers I both adored and was intensely rivalrous with. My parents were very caring and loving. They had a lot of strengths. They had certain limitations, as everybody does, as every parent does. So my dad could be critical and my mom could be dependent. But in the words of Winnicott, they were good enough parents. They loved us and cared for us as best they could, and there was certainly no trauma in my childhood. Even as a child, though, there were signs that not all was right. I had phobias and obsessions and night terrors. As a teenager, I had a brief period of anorexia and a brief flirtation with drug use that, in kind of an overreaction, landed me in an after-school drug rehab. Perhaps more alarmingly, I started to have episodes of disorganization. The first time it happened, I had been asking my dad about going to the beach several times, and he finally snapped at me and said, "Don't you listen, Elyn, I told you we're not going to the beach." And at that moment, it felt like myself lost its coherence. It was like it was a sandcastle with all the sand sliding away in the receding surf. Nothing to take things in, no center to take things in, put them together and make sense of things. And hence, following Yeats, I call my book The Center Cannot Hold. My first frankly psychotic experience happened when I was in the drug program. I was about 15 or 16. I had read Sylvia Plath's Bell Jar, and it spoke to me, as it does to many teenage girls. And one morning, in the middle of class, I simply got up and started walking home. And as I was walking, I felt the houses started communicating with me, quoting from my book. "As I walked along, I began to notice that the colors and shapes of everything around me were becoming very intense. And at some point, I began to realize that the houses I was passing were sending messages to me. 'Look closely,' they said. 'You are special. You are especially bad. Look closely and you shall find. There are many things you must see, see, see.'" I didn't hear these words as literal sounds, as though the houses were talking and I were hearing them. Instead, the words just came into my head. They were ideas I was having. Yet I instinctively knew they were not my ideas. They belonged to the houses, and the houses had put them in my head. By the time I walked through my parents' front door, 2, maybe 3 hours later, I was tired, hot, and very frightened. I told my parents about my experience, ending the passage. They drove me to the drug program I was in, and nothing ever again was said about the episode. And I guess if I have one regret about childhood, it's that my parents didn't see that I really needed a serious mental health treatment even then. It was a very different age and time. Mental health was not on people's radar screen the way it is today. So I went to college at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. My parents wanted me to stay in the South, away from those liberal northern influences. I did extremely well. I got straight A's, I was first in my class, and I was able to make one of my closest friends and a man named Kenny, who I'm still close with today. But there were portents of my illness even then. My first year, my personal hygiene was truly appalling, and my first and last years I had out of control episodes, which I could bring to a conclusion, but were scary nonetheless. I eventually won a Marshall Scholarship to study ancient philosophy at Oxford, and there my world really started falling apart. I became officially mentally ill. It started out looking like depression with mild paranoid features, as schizophrenia often does start out, but over time it became more of a thought disorder than a mood disorder. In any case, I was depressed, and I lost a lot of weight. At 5'10", I was under 100 pounds. I became socially isolated. I thought I wasn't supposed to speak because I thought speaking would spread my evil around, and it's really hard to make friends if you don't speak. I believe that many people were talking about me and laughing at me behind my back, which may have been true because I think I looked quite a sight walking around the Oxford campus talking to myself and just gesticulating. More alarmingly, I began to have vivid fantasies of killing myself because that was all I was worthy of. Dousing myself with gasoline and lighting a match was my preferred approach. I went to my GP, who urgently sent me to a psychiatrist, who urged me to check into the Warnford Hospital, and eventually I did go. That first hospitalization lasted a month. At one point, I had a shock that led me to try to get out of the hospital as fast as I could. I looked into the mirror, quoting from the text. It was the first time I'd actually seen myself in weeks, and it felt as if someone had punched me in the stomach. Good God, I thought, who is that? I was emaciated and hunched over like someone 3 or even 4 times my age. My face was gaunt, my eyes were simultaneously vacant and full of terror. My hair was wild and filthy, my clothes wrinkled and stained. It was a visage of a crazy person on the long-forgotten back ward of a hospital for lunatics. Ending the passage. I got out of the hospital as quickly as I could, determined never to come back. I was not going to be a revolving door patient. This would be my first, my last, and my only hospitalization. And then 8 months later, I did come back, so much for resolve. Quoting from the text, in my fog of isolation and silence, I began to feel I was receiving commands to do things, such as walk all by myself through the old abandoned tunnels that lay underneath the hospital. I also felt commanded to inflict pain on myself because that was all I was worthy of. So I burned myself through many different means. I didn't tell staff that the impetus for my behavior, the commanding impulse, was not mine, but came from thoughts put inside my head. I was afraid they'd laugh at me, and as frightened as I was, the thought of their derision frightened me even more. Ending the passage. Nearly 4 months in the hospital passed by, and I was not getting better. I was only getting worse. Eventually, the hospital referred to me to a famous psychoanalyst and psychiatrist named Dr. Anthony Storr, and I met with him, and I felt for the first time heard. The hospital doctors were all about giving me advice, sleep more, eat more, that kind of thing. He wanted to know what my thoughts and feelings and fantasies were. So again, I felt for the first time heard. So his advice was twofold. First, unlike the hospital doctors who were urging me to withdraw from school and go back to the States, he thought I should stay in my program because working as a student gave me self-esteem and a sense of focus. He was right about that. And a second recommendation was equally wise and probably wouldn't have been given here, and that's that I get into psychoanalytic treatment. Indeed, Storr's report, which I read much after the fact, was truly prescient. It said, quote, for a girl like this, it's psychoanalysis or nothing. Quoting from the text, my new analyst, Elizabeth Jones, greeted me at her front door. She resembled any elderly British matron, tall, large-boned, and stately, wearing a long flower dress to touch the tops of her shoes. During my sessions with Mrs. Jones, I whispered because I was convinced that people in the house next door or across the street were able to hear what I was saying. Some of the beliefs that had begun at the Warnford controlled my thoughts and were poised, that beings in the sky controlled my thoughts and were poised to hurt me, took center stage in my thinking again. I would mutter complete nonsense, disconnected words and rhymes, which even as I whispered them out loud gave me great shame. I didn't want Mrs. Jones to hear them in spite of her absolute, quote, tell everything rule. Mrs. Jones was different than the hospital doctors. Her training had prepared her well for me, and she went directly to the heart of the matter, in the process sparing neither my feelings nor my assumptions about how a proper British matron should speak. If I expressed concern that I was not smart enough for my studies at Oxford, she would reply, you were first in your class at Vanderbilt. Now you're upset about Oxford because you want to be the best and you're afraid you can't be. You feel like you're a piece of shit from your mother's bottom. While the content of what Mrs. Jones said to me was not always a comfort, her presence in the room was so calm, so reasonable, no matter what bizarre words and images she or I used, no matter what I said to her, no matter how disgusting or horrible, she did not recoil or flinch or shift back in her chair or blink in disbelief or disgust. To her, my thoughts and feelings were not right or wrong, good or bad. They just were. Soon, Mrs. Jones herself became the overt object of my fantasies. So much for Freud's view that patients with psychosis can't form transferences. I know you say you're my analyst, I snarled at her one memorable afternoon, but I also know the truth. You're an evil monster, perhaps a devil. I won't let you kill me. You're evil, a witch. I'll fight. Walking by kitchen stores, I stared through the display windows at the knives, thinking I should buy one and take it to my next session. Once I even went into a hardware store to look at the axes, wondering which, if any, might protect me. And for a while, I carried a serrated kitchen knife and a box cutter in my purse to my sessions, just in case. At the very same time I was terrified of losing Mrs. Jones, I was equally terrified that I was going to lose her. At the very same time I was terrified of Mrs. Jones, I was equally terrified I was going to lose her. I would plot ways to keep Mrs. Jones from abandoning me, my thoughts. I will kidnap her and keep her tied up in my closet. I will take good care of her. I will give her good food and nice clothes. She will always be there when I need her to give me psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis on demand. And then once back in her office, I tell her every single evil thing, ending the passage. Notwithstanding the deepening of my psychosis, my work with Mrs. Jones proved very fruitful. I began to be able to work again and make friends again. It was as if the analysis interrupted the malignant negative symptoms of schizophrenia, apathy, withdrawal, inability to work, and so on. Anyway, I graduated from Oxford creditably and went on the market to go to law school. Still, my last session with Mrs. Jones was truly catastrophic, with her and her analyst husband trying physically to forcibly remove me from her waiting room while I cried and screamed. When I finally left at the end of the day, she patted me on the back and said, "Take courage, Elyn, take courage." Ending the passage. So I decided to go to Yale for law school, and I arrived there in August, and without a Mrs. Jones to turn to, I started spinning more and more out of control. I was doing well academically, but then started to be unable to work. Parenthetically, the hospital later would say that I was dangerous to myself and others, and they also said I was gravely disabled, and the reason they wrote down that I was gravely disabled is I couldn't do my Yale Law School homework, which made me wonder about much of the rest of New Haven. I was forced to stay in the Yale infirmary one weekend, and then they kicked me out as too difficult to manage. Kicked out of student health, I didn't know whether to laugh or cry. I then had a major in public breakdown the seventh week of my first semester at the Yale Law School, quoting from the text. I greeted my two classmates, Rebel and Val, in the Yale Law School library at 10 o'clock on a Friday night. We had made the day to work on our memo assignment together, but didn't get far before I was talking in ways that made no sense. Memos were visitations, I informed them. They make certain points. The point is on your head. Pat used to say that. Have you ever killed anyone? Rebel and Val looked at me like they or I had been splashed in the face with cold water. What are you talking about, Elyn? Oh, the usual, you know, heaven and hell, who's what, what's who. Hey, I said, leaping out of my chair, let's go out on the roof. It's okay, it's safe. I hurried to the nearest large window, opened it, then climbed through and stepped out onto the roof, a flat surface and not at all scary. A few moments later, Rebel and Val followed, and they asked what had gotten into me. This is the real me, I announced, waving my arms above my head. And then, late on a Friday night, on the roof of the Yale Law School Library, I began to sing, and not quietly either. Come to the Florida sunshine bush. Do you want to dance? Are you on drugs, one asked. Are you high? High me? No way, no drugs. Come on, let's dance. Come to the Florida sunshine bush, where they make lemons, where there are demons. You're frightening me, one of them said, and then Rebel and Val headed back inside. I shrugged and followed them. Back inside, I asked my classmates, are you having the same experience of words jumping around the pages as I am? I think someone's infiltrated my copy of the cases. We've got a case of joint. I don't believe in joints, but they do hold your body together. So that's an example of what we call loose associations. This was more than either of them had bargained for, and they quickly left, though I insisted on staying. Eventually, I made my way back to my room, and once there, I couldn't settle down. My head was too full of noise, too full of oranges and law memos I could not write and mass murders I knew I would be responsible for. Sitting on my bed, I rocked back and forth, moaning in fear and isolation, ending the passage. There's actually a funny story about Rebel. When I did my book, I learned that Rebel was an entertainment lawyer in LA. So I consulted him about representing me, and he said, what's your book about? And I said, it's about my mental illness. He said, really? I said, you're in it? You're in it. He said, I am? I said, yeah, remember the scene on the roof of the Yale Law School? He said, how could I forget? The next morning, I went to my professor's office to ask for an extension on our memo assignment, and started speaking unintelligibly as I had the night before, and he eventually brought me to the ER. I found myself in a small room waiting for a doctor. The attendant was kind, and I readily gave him my telephone wire belt, which I had made the night before out of telephone wire, quoting from the text. But you can't have my 6-inch nail, I said, patting my pocket. Then someone I'll call just the doctor arrived. Give that to me, he said. No, I said. He immediately called for security. Another attendant came in, this one not so nice. Once he pried the nail from my fingers, I knew I was done for. Within seconds, the doctor and his whole team of goons swooped down, grabbed me, lifted me out of the chair, and slammed me down in a nearby bed with such force that I saw stars. Then they bound both my legs and arms to the metal bed with thick leather straps. A sound came out of my mouth that I'd never heard before, half groan, half scream, barely human, and pure terror. Then the sound came again, forced from somewhere deep inside my belly and scraping my throat raw. No, I shouted, stop this, don't do this to me. I glanced up to see a face watching the entire scene through the window and the steel door. Why was she watching me? Who was she? I was an exhibit, a specimen, a bug impaled on a pin and helpless to escape. Please, I begged, please, this is like something from the Middle Ages. Please, no. Ending the passage. 5 months of hospitalization ensued, hospitalization involving long-term restraints and seclusion. So my first 3 weeks in the hospital, I would be restrained anywhere from 3 to 15 or 20 hours a day. Then I switched to another hospital. Even though my behavior didn't change, I stopped being restrained. So whether you're restrained has a lot to do with the ethos of your ward. I was also forcibly medicated at times and given little privacy. In the beginning, in fact, I was even watched when I took a shower and went to the bathroom, and I was not allowed to talk to anyone, including my parents, outside the presence of staff. I do believe that the hands-off approach, you might even call it benign neglect of the Oxford Hospital, the English Hospital, is much preferable to the over-interventionist approach of American hospitals. As I've come to say, I'm very pro-psychiatry, but very anti-force. I returned to Yale the following year. It never occurred to me that I wouldn't finish my degree, though it had occurred to a lot of other people I wouldn't. And there's a funny story around my readmission. So Yale had a policy if you were withdrawn from school for psychiatric reasons, you had to be evaluated by the head of university health to see if you're ready to come back. And like any good student, I started looking this guy up. And it's before the days of the internet, so I'm pulling books with shit from shelves and looking at periodical indices, and I find an article which is, students withdrawn from school for psychiatric reasons, evaluating them for readmission, questions you want to ask and answers you want to hear. So I was very well prepared when I did the interview. Okay, he did say I could go back. And I quickly got into psychoanalytic treatment again, as I knew what had worked in the past and I was going to take advantage of that. Dr. White was the quintessential Yale professor who practiced in the tradition of classical analysis, which is more respectful of defenses than my earlier Kleinian analyst. He often interpreted what was going on with me, and in that way, helped detoxify some frightening thoughts, quoting from the text. "I think you're talking about threatening and scary ideas because you feel threatened and scared yourself," he said. "The violence is your defense against fear. You're safe here." So, ending the passage, I went through Yale in the usual 3 years, did very well academically, did clinical work representing psychiatric patients and children, and graduated as class marshal in 86, and that was a very lovely day. After graduating for law school, I worked for 8 months in a legal service organization in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and it was a terrible job for me. It was, at the same time, very stressful and very boring. So I got into a minor teaching position to stay near Dr. White. And then I was planning to go on the teaching market nationally a couple years later. But then White announced that he was going to retire in 3 months, fully a year and a half before I had intended on leaving. Eventually he reversed himself, saving me what would probably have been another hospitalization. I was that upset. I guess you could say I have separation issues, Mrs. Jones, Dr. White. I was fortunate when I went on the teaching market to get several good jobs, and I took the best, which was University of Southern California Gould School of Law. I got into treatment immediately with a former student of Dr. White's, someone who had been an analyst and a hospital doctor, so he was experienced working with patients like me. White has told him not to be too scared of me, and to his credit, when I had an episode, he wasn't. While White supported me in my many efforts to get off medication, which I undertook with great gusto and failed miserably at, a battle sort of brewed between me and Kaplan. He thought I should just stay on the meds and get on with my life, but for me the motto was the less medicine, the less effective. The way I could prove that I wasn't really mentally ill, that it was all a big mistake, was getting off drugs and staying off them. Quoting from the so he wanted me to stay on. I said, I want to try one last time to get off. I'm going to give it my very best shot. Quoting from the text. So I started the reduction. I hid what I was feeling when I started feeling bad. The days and nights were harder now. The sheer physical effort of containing my body and my thoughts felt like trying to hold back a team of wild horses. Sleep was spotty and filled with dreams that left me awake and sweating in terror. Nevertheless, I dropped down again. Months before, I accepted an invitation to present at a workshop at Oxford. By the time I boarded the plane for home, I was a complete wreck. When I walked into Kaplan's office my first day back, I headed straight for the corner, crouched down on the floor, and began to shake. All around me were thoughts of evil beings poised with daggers. They'd slice me up in thin slices or make me swallow hot coals. Kaplan later described me as, quote, writhing in agony. Even in this state, what he accurately described as acutely and floridly psychotic, I refused to take more meds. The mission is not yet complete. Immediately after the appointment with Kaplan, I went to see Dr. Martyr, a schizophrenia expert who was following me for a movement disorder caused by the medication called tardive dyskinesia. He'd never seen me ill before and had been under the impression that I had a mild psychotic illness and just wanted to minimize the risk of TD. Once in his office, I sat on his couch, folded over, and began muttering. I was disheveled. I couldn't remember when I'd slept or what I'd eaten. When had I bathed? In Oxford? Before Oxford? Did it matter if we were all going to die anyway? Anyone who walked into that room would have thought Martyr was treating a schizophrenic street person. Weeks later, people told me that's exactly what I looked like. Head explosions and people trying to kill. Is it okay if I totally trash your office? You need to leave if you think you're going to do that, said Martyr. Okay, small, fire on ice, tell them not to kill me, tell them not to kill me. What have I done wrong? All the explosions, hundreds of thousands with thoughts, interdiction. "Elyn, do you feel like you're dangerous to other people or to yourself?" he asked. "That's a trick question," I said. "I don't think you ask a mental health law professor if she meets the statutory criteria for commitment in the language of the statute. I'm not sure how you do it, but..." No, it's not a trick question," he said. "I'm serious. I think you need to be in the hospital. I could get you into UCLA right now, and the whole thing could be very discreet." "Ha, ha, ha. You're offering to put me in the hospital? Hospitals are bad. They're mad. They're sad. One must stay away. I'm God, or I used to be. Actually, my husband, Will, looked at this passage in a manuscript form and made a marginal note where it said, 'I'm God, or I used to be.' He said, 'Did you quit, or were you fired?'" "I give life, and I take it away. Forgive me, for I know not what I do." "I really think a hospital would be a good idea," Martyr said. "No, thank you, oh so very much," I said. "All right then, but if I were you, I'd stay away from work for a while. We don't want your colleagues to see this. Thanks, banks, bang, bye, see you soon." Oblivious to the look on his face, I left. The next morning, I did drag myself to my office, my hideout and refuge, and ran into my colleague, Ed, and he quickly figured out what was happening. "Elyn, what the hell's going on? I thought you were kidding at first, but you're not, are you? Does anyone else know? Is it okay for anyone else to know?" "I wouldn't mind to tell Michael," I said, "not the archangel, my colleague," ending the passage. Suffice to say, Ed showed the good judgment to follow the recommendation of my psychiatrist and drive me home, rather than everyone else, including his internist wife, suggesting that he tackle me to the ground and bring me to the ER. Eventually, I acceded to everyone's demands that I take more medication. I could no longer deny the truth, and I could not change it. The wall that kept me, Elyn, Professor Saks, separate from the insane woman I had seen in that mirror long ago, lay smashed and in ruins. And then another event further convinced me that perhaps I did indeed have a mental illness. I got on a new drug. Quoting with the text, from the text. "Because of the risk of my meds, Kaplan suggested one of the new classes of antipsychotics, a drug called Zyprexa. Parenthetically, I ended up on a huge dose of that and had a lot of breakthrough symptoms, so I switched to clozapine, which is cumbersome, but the Cadillac in terms of efficacy, and it's not perfect, but it works really well. Anyway, with the Zyprexa, going back to the text, the change was fast and dramatic. First, the side effects were much less than with Novan. More important, the clinical result was, not to overstate it, like daylight dawning after a long night. I could see the world in a way I'd never seen it before. The illness was still there, but it wasn't pushing me around as much as it once did. Finally, I could focus on the task at hand, unencumbered by the threat of lurking demons. The most profound effect of the new drug was to convince me once and for all that I actually had a real illness. For 20 years, I struggled with that acceptance, managing to hold on to the belief, basically, that there was nothing unusual about my thoughts. Everyone's mind contained the chaos that mine did. They were just better at managing it than I. My problem, I thought, had less to do with my mind than it had to do with my lack of social graces. I wasn't mentally ill. I was socially maladroit. Of course, that wasn't true. There's no way to overstate what a thunderclap this revelation was to me. And with it, my final and most profound resistance to the idea I was mentally ill began to give way. Ironically, the more I accepted I had a mental illness, the less the illness defined me. It became accident, as it were, and not essence, at which point the riptide that had kept sucking me in set me free. Ending the passage. When I decided what I wanted to do with my life post-tenure and post-acceptance of mental illness, it was to pursue a dream I had had, my friend Kenny reminded me, since freshman year in college, to be psychoanalytically trained. When I got sick, I thought that wouldn't be possible, but I was very stable now, and my analyst supported me doing this. I did the didactic part of the course and got my PhD, wrote a thesis and got a PhD. I started clinical training. I treated 3 or 4 psychotherapy cases and 1 psychoanalytic case. But when my book came out, I decided to not finish the clinical part of the program because my book complicates the therapist-patient relationship too much. You know, you're supposed to be a blank screen, and that's exactly what I'm not. And anyway, my institute has been very supportive around my publication of my book and disclosure of my illness. Now that I felt happy with my life professionally, I felt finally free to explore other aspects of life, in particular, romance. I had dated normally in high school and college, but when I got ill, that part of life went by the wayside. I basically went 18 years with 2 or 3 dates in the middle, not dating at all. I was too tormented by my internal demons to be able to manage that kind of relationship, and also had the usual psychological mishigas that I worked on in therapy. Quoting from the text, when it came to my personal life, after my illness had died down somewhat, I started nurturing a fragile but growing hope for a relationship with a man named Will, a librarian at USC and an artist. Hand up, Will. I had tried flirting with him to no avail. He was a weekend library person. I would go down to say I needed to send a fax and try to flirt, but I guess I didn't do very well. Anyway, Will left USC, and walking in the halls one day, we ran into each other, and I said, let's do lunch sometime. So we had a really nice lunch. And then he invited me to see the poppies at Lancaster, which were really gorgeous. And I kept saying how chilly I was, hoping he would put his arm around me, but he never did. But then at the end of the day, he gave me a long, lingering kiss goodnight. And the thought I had at that moment, this is literally what went through my head, was, huh, this is even better than getting an article accepted. Actually, between lunch and going to the poppies, Will came to my office with a feather from his parrot, which he pasted on my computer. And I asked my friend Kenny from Vanderbilt that night, and I'm not sure why I put it this way, because I didn't think that had happened, but I said, Kenny, you think a guy who plucks a feather from his parrot and pastes it on your computer likes you? He said, I don't know, Elyn, but one thing for sure, he likes you better than he likes his parrot. Actually, at that moment, he liked his parrot much more. Back to the text. I wanted a relationship with Will, and slowly I believed that it might actually happen. Eventually, I told Will that I loved him, and indeed that he was the first man I had ever loved in that way. He said that made him very sad. At the right moment, I told him about my illness, and he responded as gently and kindly as a person could. If my friend Steve's friendship made me feel human, Will was making me feel like a woman, ending the passage. Eventually, Will and I married. We kid around, only five more minutes? Ooh. Well, I thought it, okay. We simply skipped the first marriage, and he insisted on making the wedding cake and made a wedding invitation set to the theme of I Love Lucy. So I'm going to quote from the last passage of my book. Recently, a friend posed a question. If there were a pill that would instantly cure me, would I take it? The poet Rainer Mary Rilke was offered psychoanalysis and declined, saying, don't take my devils away because my angels may flee too. I can understand that. Mania and manic depression has been described as a sometimes pleasurable high that brings with it feelings of omnipotence. But that's not the experience of schizophrenia, at least not for me. My psychosis is a waking nightmare in which my demons are so terrifying that all my angels have already fled. So would I take the pill? In a heartbeat. That said, I don't wish to be seen as regretting the life I could have had if I'd not been ill, and nor am I asking anyone for their pity. What I rather wish to say is that the humanity we all share is more important than the mental illness we may not. With proper treatment, someone who's mentally ill can lead a full and rich life. What makes life wonderful, good friends, a satisfying job, loving relationships, is just as valuable for those of us who struggle for schizophrenia as anyone else. For a person with mental illness, the challenge is to find the life that's right for you. But in truth, isn't that the challenge for all of us, mentally ill or not? My good fortune is not that I've recovered from mental illness. I have not, nor will I ever. My good fortune lies in having found my life. Thank you.
Should I not do the legal part? Not do the legal part?
Okay, I'm going to take an extra 5 minutes, yeah, if that would be okay. Talking about the legal part. To prepare for this, I asked my library to find Ninth Circuit cases, and there were many such cases in criminal law, education, employment, health insurance, prisoners' rights. Very impressed with the recent decision by Judge Peckman on timely evaluation of competency to stand trial. I'm going to focus on right to refuse medication of involuntarily committed civil patients. I then turn to capacity to refuse and briefly capacity in other contexts. I don't look at a related issue, which you have discussed in the Ninth Circuit, the right to refuse medication in competency stands trial context. I don't look at right to refuse in the penal context, the Supreme Court has already spoken to this, and I don't look at right to refuse medication that will render one to be competent to be executed. I also don't look at involuntary confinement generally, right to refuse other modalities like ECT, or coerced treatment with medication under compulsory outpatient law. So I'm going to begin by giving the lay of the land on right to refuse. So basically, across the country, about half the states confer a right to refuse medication in involuntary patients unless they're incompetent or it's an emergency. A number of Ninth Circuit jurisdictions take this view as well. The second group allows medication if other conditions are met, for example, that if you don't take medication, you're going to have a much prolonged treatment course. And then the third group lets people to be medicated if they're mentally ill and in need of treatment. So the Ninth Circuit states are represented in all three of these. So there are a right to refuse if you're competent, an intermediate standard, for instance, in Washington revised code, and most paternalistic kind of standard, for example, in Montana, which you can medicate someone if you find that involuntary medication is necessary to protect the respondent or the public or to facilitate effective treatment. Note the states taking positions on the right to refuse doesn't mean there's no issue for federal courts. For example, if the courts find that the Constitution allows forced medication absent an emergency only in the face of incompetency, then the statutes and cases in these jurisdictions that use a lesser standard would be out of compliance with federal law. So I'm going to skip the pros and cons of right to refuse and basically say if we adopt the most progressive standard, namely right to refuse, competence to refuse, what is it to be competent, and how should we understand substituted decision making? Considerable work has been done in the U.S. on capacity and competence. To me, our capacity standards strike a balance among three values: protecting the patient's autonomy, serving their well-being paternalistically, and recognizing that there's a pervasive irrationality that affects much decision-making. These values pull apart. If, for example, we require correct beliefs, we trench on a person's autonomy to believe as he or she chooses, and we may sweep too many in because there's a lot of irrationality in the world. If we require grossly false beliefs, on the other hand, we may allow people to make decisions that are bad for them without sufficient understanding. Several instruments to measure competency have been developed, and I review those instruments in an American Journal of Psychiatry article. The MacArthur instruments are pretty much the gold standard. They evaluate for understanding, appreciating, reasoning, and expressing a choice. Their instruments have good reliability and validity. On the other hand, they may require too much in the way of correct results. I've designed an instrument to measure appreciation. While on MacArthur's appreciation scale, 25% are incompetent. On mine, only a little over 12% are. So I want to talk briefly about capacity in other contexts. It's what characterizes an autonomous agent. Decisions in all areas require a competent decision maker. Often competent decision making fails because the person doesn't understand or appreciate relevant facts about their decision. For instance, in testamentary capacity, one must be able to understand, among others, the nature and object of one's bounty. If one has a patently false belief about potential beneficiaries, that can vitiate consent. The question again is how deficient the beliefs must be. The cases talk about, quote, insane delusions, which I suggest are patently false beliefs. Compare, for example, a belief that one's relative has been taken over by the devil versus that he doesn't like you very much. In contractual capacity cases, one again looks at the quality of a person's belief about the transaction. Suppose he has a belief that he must sign the contract or a nuclear holocaust will occur. In competency to be executed, one must understand that and why one is to be executed. Again, how deficient must beliefs be to render one incompetent? If you believe there's no such thing as death or that you're invulnerable and can't be executed, that's likely enough. Or if you think you didn't commit the crime but some alien being took over your body and did it, that might count as well. What if you believe that your conviction was a result of a conspiracy? Is that a grave enough distortion to amount to incapacity? Okay, so I want to conclude by mentioning some policy implications of my story with the thought that there may be cases that come before you where you can help these things happen. First, we need to step up to the plate and provide resources for people with mental illness. Mine's not the story of a lone woman who overcame great odds through sheer force of will. I'm someone into whom enormous treatment benefits resources were invested. If we want people to live up to their pre-illness potential, we must provide resources for them to do that. In this regard, the Federal Parity Act can provide resources to people who otherwise wouldn't get them. Implementation of the law is now going through the courts. A former student, in fact, has brought several class actions. Outside the insurance context, would there be any other way legally to incentivize states to provide more and better treatment? Perhaps we should revive the quid pro quo doctrine that in exchange for losing your liberty to civil commitment, you're given the benefit of adequate treatment. Second, we must try to limit the use of force. It's an unstable solution, may lead to future avoidance care, and is painful and degrading. As I've suggested, we must try to find ways to get people to want treatment so we don't have to use force. Force is obviously a liberty issue. Third, I think the use of mechanical restraints is very toxic, and we must find ways to limit their use. Next, we must stop criminalizing mental illness. I note this is something I've never personally experienced. I've had no contact with the police, but I worry about it. It's a national scandal that the LA County Jail is the largest psych facility in the country. American prisons and jails are filled with people who struggle with mental illness, and many of them are there because they've never received appropriate treatment. I could easily be there or on the streets. I'm pleased to mention that this issue is getting a lot of attention lately. For example, the LA County Department of Health and the LA County District Attorney, Jackie Lacey, are on board in setting up a jail diversion program so people with mental health disorders are diverted from the criminal justice system and into the treatment system. Finally, we need to reduce stigma. Even with excellent treatment, wonderful friends and family, and an enormously supportive work environment, I did not make my illness public until relatively late in my life. And that's because the stigma against mental illness is so powerful that I didn't feel safe with people knowing. And so kind and smart and well-meaning people who wouldn't dream of using a racial or ethnic slur talk happily of nutcakes, Looney Tunes, crazies, and wackos. I have a psychologist friend who has schizophrenia, Fred Fries, who asks people to please no longer use the N-word, i.e. nuts. If you hear nothing else today, then please hear this, that there are not schizophrenics, there are people with schizophrenia. And these people may be a parent, maybe your sibling, maybe your neighbor, maybe your colleague. In short, we need for people to be more conscious of how they speak and act, and we need a more respectful and responsible media. And judges, of course, must be alert to stigma in their courts. In conclusion, I hope this conversation will have given you some insight into the mind of someone suffering with psychosis. In a word, people with psychosis want what everyone wants, in the words of Sigmund Freud, to love and to work. Understanding mental illness better, I hope, will enable you to address mental health law issues in your courts in a more informed and mindful way. Thank you again for inviting me to be here today.
All right, well, I'm going to try to channel some of the questions I suspect most of us have, and there will be time for others perhaps at the end, but I want to start by just saying how inspiring Professor Saks' story is. It's very hard to convey how much people with chronic mental illnesses suffer, and to triumph over it in the way that you have is makes me very hopeful, and I think should make all of us very hopeful.
Thank you very much.
Something that you talked about, and I think just bears more emphasis, is the effect of having been treated with force.
Okay.
And we were talking earlier this morning, you talked about how your experience in hospitals that used force actually made it more difficult for you to get the treatment that you needed. Could you say more about that?
Yeah, I actually think use of force deters future care. So I've had periods of time since my hospitalization 82, 83, where I probably would have benefited from going into the hospital, but I was just too traumatized by how I'd been treated and stayed as far away as I could. And I think that happens with other people. I mean, force is an unstable solution. You know, once you stop administering it, the person has no reason not to go back. It's painful and degrading. And doesn't lead to good treatment results. I compare my own experience between England and America, because in England they use a lot less force. And I try to figure out why that might be, and might just be cultural, that British people are less violent than we are anyway, or they're more respectful of authority. But it may just be the culture. As I said, you know, restraints practices varied widely in the hospitals I was in. And I think practices here vary from what goes on there, and I think it would be a cool thing if some American psychiatry people went to England and kind of observe how they do it.
Mm-hmm. So you actually can prevent people who are psychotic from hurting themselves or hurting other people without using...
You know, restraints actually, as Harvard statistician estimates that every week in this country, 1 to 3 people die in restraints. They aspirate their vomit, they have a heart attack, they strangle. Given that you can protect other people from themselves by other means like staff specialing or even going back to padded cells, are we saving lives or costing lives by using mechanical restraints? So it's not really clear to me.
Okay, and so it's bad in the sense of the future of the patient, but it also discourages people from getting help.
Yeah. Well, it scares other patients on the ward to death.
Right.
And, you know, it's...
Well, we'll speak.
I had so many nightmares after my rashes. Yeah. I used to have a nightmare that I somehow got the keys to the seclusion room and somehow managed to get all the staff into the seclusion room and lock them in and open the doors for all the patients to walk out. Yeah. I mean, I had fantasies like that.
Yeah, right. Well, speaking of fear,
right.
Those of us who have seen people in floridly psychotic states, I mean, it's kind of scary, right?
Yeah.
My sense from the interactions I had representing people was that was the biggest barrier to getting people to pay attention, was just they were scared.
Right.
Has that been your experience as well?
Let me see. I think a lot of people are afraid, and I think the trick is to realize that, as I said in my talk that Dr. White interpreted, when people are aggressive and violent, it's because they're really scared. Mm-hmm. And when someone's really scared, if you get scared in turn, that just ratchets up the emotions. So the ideal thing to do is kind of keep your steady, calm, and interact in a non-threatening way, and that kind of thing.
So,
an ordinary person, a police using a show of force or judges being authoritarian could have the effect of people behaving better, whereas in this context, it just might make someone much, much worse.
You'll escalate the...
Escalate.
Yeah, well, that's what I was trying to get at. So judges are, we're used to trying to maintain order in our courtroom and make sure that people observe proper decorum and that kind of thing. And so somebody's psychotic and acting out. What should a judge do?
Well, I mean, I think it's really important if someone is out of control, yelling, flailing, crying, whatever, to realize that they're not just being annoying or bad actors, but that they're having an episode with some of them. And they're, very confused and very frightened and that kind of thing. Or another example is if the litigant is saying stuff that's like obviously false, could be that he or she is lying, but it could also be that they're out of touch with reality and they believe the things they say. So you need to kind of, as a judge, I think, when you work with patients with illness, be mindful of those kinds of things.
So you have to make a judgment about what's going on,
right?
And then choose your response.
Right, and it's often not easy to tell. Is the person getting out of control just, being an annoyance, or is he or she just really struggling?
So, sort of a related question to this. We're all, when I say we lawyers and judges, are trained to think in a somewhat linear way, what are the relevant facts and what are the applicable legal principles, and so we sort of define problems in a fairly specific way.
Right.
Does that construct work with mentally ill people?
Probably not. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think probably you really need to kind of dig in and see where the person's coming from, what they're thinking, what they're feeling, how confused they are, and that kind of thing. We were talking earlier that, there's starting to crop up mental health courts an example of a collaborative court. And I lost my track.
Yeah, but so you're trying to deal with the person.
Yeah. In these alternative courts, unlike in, regular criminal court where they're, you look mostly at the offense and there are kind of rules about what you sentence and stuff like that, in these mental health courts, you're really focused on the person. What does the person need? What kind of treatment and care can we get for the person? Is the person likely to comply and be adherent and all those kinds of things? It was very fact specific. And as you were saying, it's expensive, but it may be worth it.
But you're thinking more holistically.
Exactly.
You're thinking about psychology
and
emotions and context. So some people push back on that and say, well, I was trained to be a lawyer. I'm not trained to be a therapist. So what would you say to that?
I would say part of being a lawyer is being a therapist.
I think a lot of us would agree with that.
So. Yeah, probably.
For judges, too. But, I think one of the things, I remember this as an advocate, and I think some of the public defenders in the room will recognize this as well. Sometimes you have to make a decision. Your client, if your client is, you have questions about your client's competency. So you have to decide tactically. Do I want to raise this or not? Is this, and if you do, then the court has certain obligations, and you go down this road. And if you don't, then other things happen.
Right. And unlike other areas of representation, if you feel like there's a doubt about the competency, you have a moral or legal obligation.
Yeah.
which is very stressful for the lawyer-client relationship too, because the client will feel abandoned and stuff like that.
You have any guidance to give to the to public defenders about that? No?
Yeah.
Just to, other than to say it's really hard?
Exactly. It's really hard.
Another related one is you have a client who doesn't want to take meds, and you were just
right.
talking about that, with the right to refuse treatment.
Right.
And you know, you have a history of people who every time they go off meds, they end up in trouble, right?
Right.
So any counsel there?
Did I talk about the three reasons people refuse?
Yeah.
I talked
yeah,
about that
you
already.
You did, yeah.
Okay,
but I mean, just sort of specifically in a representational context or a judge,
yeah, I think you just be encouraging, you know, and yeah. make arguments and, mm-hmm.
Listen and be
exactly.
supportive. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Also, you know, sometimes with medication, people, you know, say I'm not ill. A lot of people who have mental illness have denial or lack of insight that they're ill. So why would I take pills? But you could mm-hmm. say stuff like, well, you know, you complain about sleeplessness and agitation, and these medicines will help with that too.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm,
give it a try.
Mm-hmm. So it's relating to the human being.
Exactly. The human connection is like so critical.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, which leads to another question. I mean, one of the great successes, I think, in your story is, you know, you said you fought meds, you fought
right.
the need to take meds for years and years.
10
and
years,
years.
Yeah.
And you explained why.
Right.
And some at some point you finally got
right.
to a point where you said, no, you know what, I'm just
right.
gonna do this. So how much can you tell us about what enabled you to do that?
You know, I think encouragement by my therapist, kind of getting that he might be right, that when I go on and off, I spend all my time in that land and that struggle. And so I kind of said, well, yeah, let me try being on it. And then being on it, I really wanted to be on it. It's one reason I think, you know, sometimes outpatient commitment can be a good idea, because it will keep someone on medication for 6 months and they'll
mm-hmm.
say, I want to stay on medication because
mm-hmm.
I've experienced it and it makes my life better.
Yeah. But you had to trust the therapist, right?
I did.
Yeah. And you had been with
him. I was abjectly trustful of all my therapists.
Yeah. and you also talk about in your book, you talk about how it wasn't just that, but you had people in your life
mm-hmm.
who really were there for you and really saw you.
Absolutely.
And they supported that decision too.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Which sort of leads to a sense that, you know, you think you said it, it takes a village.
Right.
If you've got somebody with a chronic mental illness.
Right.
They're not going to get through it by themselves.
Right.
Right.
I encourage all of you
yeah.
who have mental health in your families and extended families to
yeah.
really just try to stand by your loved one and help them. A lot of times relationships break off either because the patient doesn't want the family involved, sometimes for good reason, sometimes for bad reason, or because the parents are so upset that they just can't stay there. They
yeah.
flee. And my understanding is the evidence is that when you have your family involved, you have a better prognosis.
Yeah, and it certainly was true for you with friends and family.
I did not involve my parents.
Parents, yeah.
Yeah.
But your husband.
My husband and my friends.
And your friends, yeah.
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 You know, I mean, again, I'm just going to speak from personal experience, and maybe folks who have represented people who have been in a psychotic state have had the same experience. One of the things that gets hard is that if the person is floridly psychotic, they could dump a lot of abuse on you, you know.
Absolutely.
Right, you know, and so any advice or suggestions about how to hang when that happens?
Just, you know, it's the person's illness speaking. If
yeah.
they probably if they were well, they wouldn't be saying this and,
mm-hmm.
you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah. So, you know, going forward, we're trying to figure out how to make better decisions, provide
right.
better care. How do we begin to think about that, or what do we need to do?
So I think we want to really vigorously advocate for more research into what helps people and how. And my suspicion is it's not going to just be new and better meds, but
mm-hmm.
psychosocial interventions as well of different kinds.
Mm-hmm.
So we really need to study those. If we have really good treatment, we can offer it to people,
mm-hmm.
and they won't run away as much as if we give them the kind of treatment that I originally had, which doesn't work very well and has a lot of side effects and that kind of thing. What was the question again?
Well, so you know, I'm trying to figure out how can we do a better job? How can we build the resources that we need?
So part of it is better treatment and research into better treatment. Part of it is God, I'm losing my train of thought. I'm sorry.
I think you were talking earlier about building a support system.
Yeah.
That it's not just.
It's not a lone person.
Yeah. It's not the heroic therapist.
Right.
It's not just great medications.
It's, right. It,
there's
it's
a
the whole
cluster
the whole thing.
Of.
Yeah.
And the courts can help create that
right.
through the sort of the specialized court approach, the mental health court.
Right.
And I want to go back to something because it's something that I think is relevant to people here. In order to think about this stuff well, mm-hmm. you've got to get outside of the legal box.
Right.
You're getting into this world through a legal proceeding or a
right.
legal question,
right.
but
right.
but you can't.
It's
think
not
of
the clear black and white.
Yeah.
This law applies to this, and this is the answer. It's a very complicated. Sort of a little bit like child custody cases,
uh-huh.
you know, where it's just so fact specific and so hard to make judgments. But just sort of looking at the reasonable person doesn't cut it with people who are by definition not reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
And it might be challenging. I mean, I think being a judge or a lawyer with these kinds of folks can be challenging in a number of ways. We've mentioned some.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to give people more training. And support for working with these people.
Do we have questions from the floor?
Professor Saks, did you ever notice a natural trigger or a remedy for your flare-ups, whether exercise, nutrition?
So, mental health disorders are responsive to stress just as all illnesses are, and probably more than most illnesses. So anything stressful could be a trigger. And that could be anything from traveling to San Diego and giving a talk. Sorry. Or having house guests for a few days. I love my friends, but close quarters with people can be difficult for me. So there are things that trigger me, and I try to manage those and, you know, kind of stay away from them or deal with them as best I can. And remedies, you know, for me, actually I get a lot of email, people saying, you know, I've got something that you should really try. Stand up on a table, spin around 3 times and take vitamin E. And I always say, you know, thank you very much. Right now my treatment is working, so why change a winning horse? But what I do is I reach out to friends and my therapist when I'm having a hard time. Some people aren't willing to, you know, accept help and don't want help. But for me, you know, having caring people around me saying, you know, you're having a hard time, let's get you care, does it. As I mentioned this morning, I have a bipolar friend I tried that with, and he was totally furious. How dare you say that? So it's not one size fits all.
And just if I could just divert for a second, that is an important point that schizophrenia has a certain type of course, and certain kinds of interventions are helpful. And bipolar illness is a completely different animal, and you can't
right.
you can't simply take the same approach to everything.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
Professor Saks, you are the recipient of a genius grant. What did you do with the money?
I have to tell a funny story first. So my law school put on a really lovely. Event to honor me for getting the MacArthur, and they gave me a t-shirt that had a picture of Einstein and a picture of me, and it said, only one of us is a certified genius, to which I responded, I've been certified many times in the past, but never quite in that way. So actually, I took the money, or part of the money, and I started the Saks Institute for Mental Health Law Policy and Ethics. And we look at issues at the intersection of mental health law policy and ethics every year. We've looked at mechanical restraints, psychotropic meds in the law, criminalization of mental illness, mental health disorders in college and university students. This coming year, we're gonna be kind of sexy. We're gonna do mental health stigma in the media and try to bring in some movie people and stuff like that, and have other things in mind. I think we wanna do a year on solitary confinement of people with mental health disorders in jails and prisons. Ethical dimensions of psychiatric research is something I'm interested in, veterans in mental health law. I mean, there's just a whole range of things that we can do, and I'm very excited to have an interdisciplinary group of students and faculty interested in participating. I could have gone to the south of France.
Yeah.
Actually, when I created the Institute, I actually emailed the MacArthur people and told them what I did, and they said, that's really great, but it really is no strings attached. So.
Can you explain what your position is or view of probation requirements that defendants take their mental health-related drugs or face
seems,
sanctions?
I haven't really thought about that, but it seems very reasonable to me. If someone needs a drug and if they're only, the condition of their managing in society is taking the drug, then sure. I mean, I guess really autonomy-focused people would say, you know, it's up to you what you want to do or what risks you want to take. But in this context, you know, there's state's interest as well.
Okay. Professor Saks, imagine that you are a lawyer in your office and you believe that your client is experiencing a mental health episode. What advice do you give the lawyer and how do they respond?
Well, as you know, if you suspect someone being incompetent to participate, then you have an obligation to notify the court, which causes significant baggage being placed on the lawyer-client relationship because the client, you're doing something that the client doesn't want. But my best guess, apart from that issue, is if you think your client has a mental health disorder, get an evaluation, find a really good clinician to take a look at the person and make a judgment about whether they indeed are seriously ill or not.
Drug use can trigger psychoses. Some studies even link marijuana use to psychoses and schizophrenia. Do you think drug use is a concern for the triggering of mental illness?
Yes, I do. I mean, my understanding is that teenagers using pot have a higher likelihood of having schizophrenia, and I don't think that's a really good thing. Substance abuse, apart from marijuana, is common with people with serious and persistent mental illness. I've been fortunate never really to have that kind of problem. You know, what does that mean in terms of legalization of pot and that kind of thing? I mean, it's a different issue. But I think, you know, I think the illness is bad enough that if I had kids, I would like strongly urge them to not do drugs.
Do symptoms of schizophrenia differ in different cultures?
The culture and the time have quite a bit to do with the content of delusions. So back in the day, someone would say, I'm Napoleon. And today they'll say, I'm Madonna, or whatever. So that kind of thing makes a difference. It's also the case that if you look at non-industrial societies, developing countries, people with schizophrenia do much better than they do in like our country or other developed countries. And part of that may be that the family ties are closer and people keep the family in the family, they embrace the person. Part of it may be more tolerance of eccentricity. It's hard to say, but it is a fact that people do better in other countries.
You make mention in your book and in your talk today about your parents and how they responded to you first revealing a change in your mental status. What would you tell them today that they should have or could have done?
You know, as I've said, I basically kept them very distant from my illness. So they didn't, their hands were kind of tied. They didn't know what was going on, really. They knew I broke down at Yale. They thought the intervening years I'd been fine, and that wasn't completely true. I was lucky or resourceful enough to get the care that I needed without their participation. So that's.
Can I add something to that, Marcia? Because mm-hmm. there's actually an organization called
NAMI.
Yeah, NAMI, and it's basically the families of mentally ill people. But my experience in representing folks was that the parents had so many. If they knew that their kids really had schizophrenia or something, they were so. They were dealing with so many emotions of their own, so much guilt, so much denial, so much, you know, just imagine, you know, having that. and feeling responsible for it in some way, that that the number of times that parents really could be effective support, you know, was not, it was a real problem. I mean, some people were able to do it, and a lot of people weren't because of their own emotional issues around having a schizophrenic child. So I think it's, if you are working in this area, you know, you have really, you know, each family is different in that way, but I think it's really tough on the families.
Did I say that I think there's evidence that family involvement is good for
it's very good
for
yeah.
the
yeah.
person, but
yeah.
doesn't always happen.
Right.
There are several states in the Ninth Circuit that have physician-assisted suicide. Hmm. Do you believe that physician-assisted suicide should be extended to acute mental illness?
It's an incredibly important and difficult question. You know, one idea is someone who has a mental health disorder is not in a good place to make that decision. So if you're depressed, a hallmark of the depression is extreme pessimism and despair. And that could be leading to the decision, and it could be if you get a person on the right medication, you know, over a few weeks, their depression will lift and they'll be better. And there's always a hope for that, even if it doesn't take, if it takes longer than 3 weeks. On the other hand, if you can imagine someone who has a severe, severe, intractable depression, tried everything, meds, ECT, nothing lifts, no hope for the future, maybe that's similar to someone who says, I don't want to live the last month of my life in terrible pain from cancer. Someone saying, I don't want to live anymore with this terrible pain of depression because it doesn't seem like it's going to go away and life's not worth living. So I think it's a complicated question. I mean, for me, at the very least, you know, you would take a lot of time figuring out if this is a really good and authentic decision. And you wouldn't just take at face value someone who says, I'm depressed and I want to die. And probably my priors would be keep them alive in the hope that they'll get better.
I have a question here that I'd like to have you do a summary. I know that you spoke about the reasons why someone would refuse medications, but I have a question that's asked, can you please help us with being able to spot the reasons somebody does not want to take their meds?
Okay.
What are the things that patients will say?
I want to preface this, though, that by talking about other medications.
Okay.
Because I think psych patients get a bad rap. So I remember in intro psych in college, the study where investigators stood outside an elevator in a medical office building and counted how many people threw away their prescriptions before they got in the elevator. So nobody likes to be on medication. I guess one difference is if you get off your blood pressure medication and you go to the doctor and your pressure's high, you'll start taking meds again, whereas you can lose judgment if you become psychotic after discontinuing meds. You know, I don't think there's a foolproof way except by talking to the person and kind of trying to help them and you understand what is motivating them and, you know, what might motivate them otherwise. I want to do a study, and I'm sort of in the process of designing it with USC and UCLA, maybe UCSD, on getting people to want treatment so we don't have to use force, and we would have three groups. We would have people who got on medication immediately and stayed on it. At the far end, we would have people who have been on and off it or off it for decades, and in the middle, we have people who are on or off it for years but, quote, tipped over to being compliant or adherent like I did. And what causes people to tip? And can we do things to help people to tip sooner? So that's one of the things I want to study.
In your book, you several times talk about feeling like if I were just a better person, I might be able to conquer this. Do those with mental illness think that mental illness is somehow a moral failing?
It's a really good question, and it's really gets to the heart of whether we consumers ourselves have internal stigma about our own mental illness. As I said, people who wouldn't use different slurs talk about mental health clients in a kind of very painful way. I forgot what we were talking about.
Yeah, just the notion of how you feel about yourself, you know, is that a, having mental illness is a moral failing.
Right, so yeah. Internal stigma. Glenn Close's sister, Jessie, is bipolar. She's got an organization called Bring Change to Mind, which I'm on her board, she's on my board. And the first time I met her, she had done public service announcements with people at Grand Central Station wearing t-shirts that say schizophrenia, friend of someone with schizophrenia, et cetera. And she gave me a t-shirt that said schizophrenia. And my first thought was, well, I don't wear t-shirts to work during the week, but I do wear them on weekends. And then I thought to myself, you know, do I really want to wear a shirt that identifies me as having schizophrenia? Mm-hmm. And then I thought, you know, I've also had breast cancer, and people wear bracelets and pins and shirts in solidarity with pride and without shame. And it's not there yet with schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. And so I have my own internalized stigma. And that really, stigma, the worst thing about stigma, similar to force, is it deters people from getting care.
Right.
And people shouldn't have to suffer, but they will if they don't get care.
Right.
That's the worst part of stigma. There's also a dangerous side to stigma, which is people find out you have a mental health disorder and decide you're just having an episode. And that happened to me. I started having bad headaches, and then I started throwing up, and my friends brought me to the hospital. And I don't really remember any of this because I wasn't laying down memories. But they found my records, and they decided I was having an episode. And my friends are jumping up and down, waving their arms, saying, we've seen her psychotic many times. She does not get like this.
She's
completely
actually sick,
different.
Yeah. Yeah.
They said, sorry, we don't, you know. So they sent me home. My mom came to town. My doctor sent me back to the ER. They did a spinal tap eventually, and I was having a subarachnoid hemorrhage, which is a stroke that kills 50% of the people who get it. But I was just having an episode. My friend Steve had a client at Mass Mental who kept going to doctors about back pain. And they all kept saying, oh, it's psychosomatic. And someone finally did an x-ray, and he had a broken back. So that's something to worry about as well.
Yeah. Yeah, you get labeled, and then
exactly.
people don't see you anymore.
Exactly. That's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
Well, as a point of privilege, I'm going to ask one of my own questions.
Okay.
As somebody who never went to law school believing that I would wind up running the mental health hospitals in Washington State, you got any advice?
No. So you thought you would run the state hospital system? Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, given what you've done with your life, I think you made the right choice.
Yeah.
Please join me in thanking Professor Saks and Judge Peckman.